that also kind of reminded me of a little story. There was a farmer in Texas, and he took a trip down to Australia, and he met up with another farmer, and he was touring the farmer's land down there, seeing how farming industry was different in that area. So they get to talking, and they're walking around the Australian's farm, and he goes and shows them a large wheat field. And the Texas said, oh, we have wheat field. They just twice as large in Texas as this. So they walk around the ranch a little bit more, and the Australian shows them a herd of cattle. And the Texan starts, and he goes right in, oh, we have cattle twice as many as this, and we have longhorn cattle that's twice as large as your cows. At that point, the conversation kind of slows down, and they're walking back towards the house. As they're walking, the farmer from Texas notices an open field adjacent to the farm area, and he sees kangaroos hopping through that open field. So he stops and he asks the Australian farmers, what are those? The Australian farmer couldn't help but tease the Texan farmer and says, don't you have grasshoppers in Texas? So we have to realize that a lot of things, size-wise, sometimes is used as a comparable to make one person better than the other person. We have to remember that size, just as we hear in the gospel, that mustard seed that is ever so small and planted in that field grows into a large bush or tree where the birds have an area to live and to exist. And the same thing is true with the yeast that's utilized in baking. If you use good yeast, it's excellent for the product. Product rises, or if you're brewing something, it develops a good flavor, and it makes a complete recipe. But just a small amount of yeast, just like that small mustard seed, will really make a difference. Has anybody ever gone out for a hike, or gone backpacking, or been in the woods, and you see a large rock, and out of that large rock, right in the center, there's a small tree growing? And you often wonder, how does that tree grow on top of that rock? Well, somewhere on the top of that rock, there's a little crevice or a crack, and a small, tiny seed will find its way in there. And mixed amongst the pine needles and the dirt and the dust, that seed starts to germinate and starts to put up branches and leaves. But there's a lot happening below the surface as well. It's starting to put roots down inside that crevice, that little crack. And as the top portion grows, so does the roots underneath. And soon those roots from that small little seed start going further down that crack in that rock. Until one day, the roots overcome that rock and will split that rock. It's something that's kind of amazing if you think about it, how a tree that's no stronger than a rock could easily be crushed by that rock, but yet that tree has the ability to split that rock in two. It's something that's very, very interesting. I often notice that when I go backpacking. And this Thursday, I just happen to be leaving, so I'm going to remember this parable when they go walking amongst the woods and looking for certain items like this. But we have to remember the kingdom of God, it grows in tiny seeds, just like we mentioned today, the seeds of the wheat plant, and of course, the seeds of the weed as well. We hear three more parables in today's gospel. Jesus is offering his disciples in a crowd a teaching from his boat when the crowd is on shore. And he talks about how the weeds were planted in the field at night when everybody was asleep. Now, this is one of the most well-known parables of Jesus. Jesus describes God as a farmer, a very generous farmer. He's willing to cast seeds where other farmers wouldn't waste their time or their resources casting seeds. Because God is casting seeds out there amongst the weeds, in the rocky areas, in the areas that have very little soil. So they're on a pathway, they're all over the place. But we have to remember that not only does God cast seeds out there, but in our heavenly kingdom, someone else is casting seeds as well. And those are the weeds. And they're casting upon the earth, on the ground, the soil. That is God's working area, but it's also Satan's working area as well. Because much like the ground produces wheat, it produces weeds as well. Now, sowing weeds into someone's field is something that's unacceptable and despicable. Even in Roman times, it was prohibited, and anyone caught doing it was punished, even though they may have been doing it to an enemy of the Romans. So you can see, even far as that time, disturbing somebody's field by casting weeds into it was prohibited and looked down upon. Now let's get back to what we're actually looking at. In our gospel today, we're talking about wheat, which represents those that follow God's teaching. And we're talking about the weeds. Those represent those that follow Satan's teachings. And the seed is a word of God, but it's also the word and the actions of Satan. So we have good seed, which is wheat, and we have bad seed, which is weeds. The soil or field represents our hearts and minds, but it represents the earth. Our hearts and minds is where the seeds are cultivated. That same field, that same soil, that same heart and mind of ours can produce wheat or it can produce weeds. We have to remember that wheat produces salvation. It gives us eternal life. It gives us mercy. It gives us love from God. But the seeds from weeds produce greed, produce hatred, pain, and unhappiness. Now, once the seed is planted, there's a process that begins. Remember I mentioned it earlier? It doesn't seem like anything's going on the top, but there is something going on underneath. The seeds of weeds produce sin. These seeds are sown by Satan. He knows the right bait to use for each one of us. He knows our weaknesses, and he knows how to hide that bait, that hook inside that bait. He knows how to entice us so we're not looking at something that's going to be hurtful. And he knows how to disguise it in such a way where we often look at it. And the sad part about it is, after looking at it and examining it and knowing that it's too good to be true, we often kind of poke at it. We might take a little nibble, and then we take another little nibble, and then bang, we're hooked. We have to realize that Satan has disguised his weeds very carefully. We have to realize and look at every aspect of our actions and our words. We have to realize that seeds from wheat produce temptation. Now, temptation itself is not sin, but it's something that each and every one of us is bound to face as a human being. We cannot escape temptation. What we go through is a common inheritance of the human race. But we have to remember that God does not save us from temptation. No, God sustains us through the midst of temptation if we call upon him and we require his assistance. When we ask God for assistance, we are able to overcome temptation and we're one step closer to the eternal life with God. But if we give in to temptation, we're one step closer to death, to the darkness, the absence of our Lord. Remember, we are free to choose our actions, but we're not free to choose the results. We can make our own free choices, but we cannot avoid the consequences from those choices. I know many of us have struggled with the pain of sin, and many of us know family members or close friends who struggle with this pain, especially in our society today with these struggling times. Some of us might even feel like we have failed. I mean, people feel excluded from their co-workers. They feel excluded from work, from family, from friends, and even our church life. Well, we have to realize that we are all in this journey together. We have all made mistakes along the way. We all find ourselves sometimes in a situation that we regret, and we realize that we've made a mistake, that we've rejected common sense, we've rejected authority, or perhaps we've rejected the church's teachings. Some of us may have ignored parental advice, but now is the time to be honest. We must realize that we are very fortunate, most of us, in today's situation. We have our health. We're able to go out. Some of us work from home. Some of us still work from the office. But we have the ability to at least not necessarily smile to people behind these masks, but at least wave to them. Nod your head, acknowledge somebody. Let relationships are very important, but at the same time, we also have that same sense and that same urgency that they have become very fragile as well. There are many circumstances in today's world that do not support God's teachings. All of us know quite well that we are in those situations that will lead us to sin from time to time. We have sinned. We sometimes turn a blind eye to that sin. The only thing that we could do is ask for the Lord's forgiveness, that forgiveness that comes through Jesus Christ, His Son. Today we live in a world where good seed and bad seed coexist. This world is a great field. This field is a wanting good seed to be planted. We are reminded that God has sown good seeds, but of course the devil has sown bad weeds as well in the same field. We are not supposed to go and be judgmental, pulling up the weeds of others when we have weeds ourselves in our own lives. We leave that judgment to God. It is not our job to judge others, whether a particular person is weak or weeds, or even if their sin may be obvious, as ours is not obvious to ourselves. That is the work of God. That is the work that will be done on the day of judgment. And then God will separate the bad. He will take that weed, bundle it together, and throw it in the fire to be burned. But then He will take that meat, and it will shine forever. Right now, let us thank God that He can convert us from weeds into wheat. And let us pray for God's forgiveness and focus on our future.